So we're continuing our series in the book of Acts today, where we've coined the series theme that this is the Acts of Jesus through his apostles by the power of the Holy Spirit. So far we've seen that Jesus promised the Holy Spirit who empowered them. In fact, they literally had to, Jesus wouldn't let them do this ministry without the Holy Spirit. It's like, no, you're not leaving this room until you get the Holy Spirit. And then we see that the gospel spreads through Jerusalem, the rapid growth of the church. Then it goes to the Judea and Samaria, and then throughout the Roman Empire. Last week, we looked at chapter 16. It's a really good sermon by Alex. If you haven't watched it, I recommend you go on YouTube and check that out. But in summary, we saw how Paul and Silas, through a vision, they travelled to Macedonia, and they preached to a congregation, a small congregation outside, and a lady called Lydia, who was a dealer of purple cloth, was saved, and her and whole family is baptised. The gospel is spreading quickly. Churches are growing. And then they drive out a demon from a fortune teller who was enslaved. And because of this, they were accused of disturbing the city. And they were severely beaten by rods and put in prison. And at night in prison, instead of concentrating on the pain they would have been in, they start singing hymns. And with this, miraculously, the prison doors through an earthquake, the prison doors go wide open, and the jailer thinks that all the prisoners have gone out, knowing that he will be put to death by his boss. He is about to kill himself, but then Paul and Silas are like, no, we're still here, don't kill yourself. They preach the word to them, and again, him and his family are saved and baptized that very night. The book of Acts is crazy. It's fast-paced, and it's full of different characters, and well worth the attention and the read. In today's passage, we're in chapter 17 on your sheets. Hopefully you brought your sheets with you, from verses 1 to 15. And just in summary, this is what it's about. If you don't listen to the rest of the talk, you have the Apostle Paul. He claims that Jesus fulfills scripture. You have jealous Jews who try to stop the spread that Jesus is Messiah. And then you have the Bereans who seek the scripture, see if it matches up to what Paul is saying. And it turns out it does match up, and many believe. And the mark of a true sermon is if the sermon can be broken down into three simple points. And thankfully today it can be. Do you proclaim scripture? Do you hate scripture? Or do you seek scripture? And my idea is that you're in one of those categories. You're either proclaiming it, either hate it, or you're seeking it. It's hard to get around those categories. So first point, do you proclaim scripture? So first one on your sheets, please read with me. When Paul and his companions had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a Jewish synagogue. So they travelled from Philippi to Thessalonica. That is a 94-mile journey. To put that in context, that's like walking from here to Bournemouth. Quite the journey, right? And this wasn't like first-class travel. This wasn't going on a nice train and complaining about the leg room. No, they were walking there. And they wouldn't be complaining about the leg room. They might be complaining about, there's not enough skin on my legs and back for this journey. They were just severely flogged and beaten with rods the day before they left for this journey. It would have been horrible. But we read in Paul's account of this mission journey in the 1 Thessalonians that he came because he was entrusted with the gospel. He was entrusted with the gospel, and so is every believer. So he came there. So verse 2, as was his custom, Paul went to the synagogue, and on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from the scriptures, explaining and proving that the Messiah had to die and suffer and rise from the dead. This Jesus I am proclaiming to you is the Messiah, he said. Some of the Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a large number of God-fearing Greeks and quite a few prominent women. So Luke goes into great detail about how Paul preached to them. It was very unique. So far in the book of Acts, we haven't really seen this detail of Paul's kind of methods of evangelism. That hasn't been spoken about. I want to focus on that today, kind of Paul's methods of evangelism. So first of all, it says he reasoned on three Sabbath days. He reasoned with them from the scriptures. Now, the Greek word translated reasoned is where we get the word dialogue. Paul had a conversation with them. There was questions, there was answers, it was open. Now, Paul starts with what they accept, which was scripture. They accepted it was true. So what's the conversation about? Well, it was explaining and proving that the Messiah had to suffer and rise from the dead. The word explaining literally means to open up, to reveal for the first time. And Paul opened with the job of explaining is to do it as simple as possible so many people understand. But there's more than that. I don't know if you remember the account of Road to Emmaus, where Jesus is walking with two of his followers. And he explained the scriptures of how he fulfilled from the law and prophets all the way through to the Old Testament, that he fulfilled them. And then when the followers came back to the disciples and they said what happened, they had this incredible Bible study with Jesus, and they said, didn't our hearts burn when he opened up the scriptures to us? Now, there's a difference from reading the Bible in a kind of intellectual way and compared to God revealing and opening up to us. We might have read the scripture before and not understood it. And it'd be, okay, that sounds great. But there's a time when God convicts us through the Holy Spirit and we understand it. It opened up to us. Paul writes in 1 Thessalonians about this. He says, our gospel came to you not simply with words, but also with power, with the Holy Spirit and deep conviction. And it's with that power of the Holy Spirit, the scriptures was opened up to them. Something that was known to them was finally opened up to them. And he proven that the Messiah had to suffer and rise from the dead. The Jews that day hoped the Messiah would redeem Israel from and overthrow the rule of the Romans and establish an earthly kingdom. But really, the Messiah came to redeem them not from Rome, but from their greatest enemy, sin. The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. So they're proving that Messiah had to suffer and rise from the dead. Who's read Isaiah 53 before? That great account of the suffering servant. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. For we, like sheep, have all gone astray. Each of us turned to our own way. But the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Paul was preaching that the Messiah had to suffer for our iniquities. So proven basically means to place beside. So Paul presented Old Testament prophecies with how Jesus lived his earthly ministry and the death and resurrection. And he kind of matched up. I'm watching a lot of Line of Duty at the moment, and you have the officers, the police officers, that they're trying to find evidence of to solve the case of, like, we think it's him, we got to find enough evidence. And in the Old Testament, there's plenty of evidence that Jesus is the one. That the Messiah would be born of a virgin. In Isaiah 7, he'd be a descendant of David to Samuel, would perform signs for healings. Isaiah 35, would bear our sins and suffering in our place. Isaiah 52, 53, be forsaken and pierced. Psalm 22, would be resurrected. Psalm 16, Jesus fulfilled 300 prophecies on his earthly ministry. Over 300. From where he was born to how much he will be betrayed by. Jesus was the Messiah. And Paul was making a case that Jesus is the Messiah, is your Messiah who you've been waiting for. So he explained and he proved, but he also proclaimed. So proclaiming is announcing good news, most likely positive news. And the danger is we forget that this is news to people. I don't know about you, well, for the last couple of months, since I moved house, literally, for all lockdown, I used to watch the news. I got into a routine of watching like 2 hours of the news every day. BBC Breakfast, love it. You know, Charlie and Naga just love the news. You watch the first hour and then the next hour is just a repeat, really. But you're still watching it. And you think, I really need to do something. But you're still watching it. And so for like 1 year, I was really clued up what was going on. But the last 3 months, I just been too busy. And I just haven't watched any news. If there's news, big news in the world right now, you would have to come and tell me. I've got no idea right now what's going on. There's people who have no idea about the good news of Jesus, how Jesus came and died the death that they deserve to die. The good news that even though we are sinners and should be cut off from God, by God's amazing, gracious love for us, that he died the death that we deserve to die and offers us forgiveness through faith, not by works, so we can enjoy a restored relationship with God now, indwelt with the Holy Spirit to be guided and then enjoy eternal life with him forever. People don't know this news. So the church has this job of proclaiming it. Every time we meet, and by God's grace, every time we meet our friends and family, we need to proclaim. Without proclaiming, there's no church. It's a social gathering which feels good. So what's the result? Some of the Jews were persuaded, it says, and joined Paul and Silas, as did a large number of God-fearing Greek and quite a few prominent women. Now, this is a really short account of what actually happened and the effect of Paul's ministry there. Really short. But thankfully, we have 1 Thessalonians, and it's on your sheets, and I'm hoping that after the main talk today, we can just we can look at it together. And it's really encouraging and amazing. Basically, in summary, you have Paul saying on different parts of the letter that I don't even have to write about instructions about how to love each other, because your love is known through the whole Macedonia. I don't have to write to you. I'm not going to waste my ink on talking about instruction about how you should have your faith and what your faith should look like. I don't need to do that because your faith is known throughout the whole area. this 3-week ministry of Paul proclaiming, of Paul proving, explaining, of God revealing and opening up had such an effect with transformed lives, and a new church began. Just through opening the Bible. Well, going to Scripture. So the application for us today, I would say it's simple as we don't need to say anything that clever, really. We need to come up with the practice, the custom of opening a Bible in front of people. When I explain verses to my friends, one of my favourite verses is Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. And I can break that down and talk to people, but I find it much easier and much better when I go, okay, just have it on my phone, here you go, look at this, read it. And they're reading the Word of God. It's like, oh my goodness, this is my best friend, and he's reading this. He's reading words that can bring him life and restore a relationship with him and God. And he's reading it. And God willing, one day, God will open it up to him. But you can do that only by the Word of God. So what's our custom? What's our custom? It's Paul's custom to go to the synagogue. What's our custom? What's our methods of evangelism? Should we try to take on some of what the great Apostle Paul does? By opening up Scripture. Jim's custom. Go to the gym and evangelize in the sauna. What's your custom? Do you have a custom? Is it not a thing to be? Is there too much on? We need a custom. We need to open up the Bible and let God speak. So many believed, but not all believed, and a lot of people hated. The gospel does divide. Verse 5 and point 2. Do you hate Scripture? So read with me, verse 5. But other Jews were jealous, so they rounded up some bad characters from the marketplace, formed a mob, and started a riot in the city. This is a pattern in the book of Acts, that jealous people among the Jewish community will stir up a crowd, will get other people on their side, and stop the spread of the gospel. Before they got, in other accounts, they got people who were like, men of high standing to form a mob. This time there was no men like that around. So what did they do? Well, they just they went to the marketplace and they just said, well, I'm going to find some bad characters. So he goes to the marketplace. He looks good. He looks bad. Yeah, he looks bad. Yeah, I'll go to him. And they go to them. We're going to form a mob today. That sounds great. Do you want to join? Well, I've got nothing else on. That's great. I'll join you. What's it about? Don't worry. I'll tell you later. And they form this mob with bad characters. And what do they do? Well, firstly, why are they described as being jealous? It sounds like they're angry. But that anger has come from jealousy. And we understand through Romans 11 why they were jealous. So because of their transgression, because of the Jews' transgression, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel envious. To make Israel envious. So God plans to use this jealousy of a closer relationship with God to be enjoyed by Gentiles, to provoke the Jews to eventually come to him. But in the meantime, they wanted to stop the spread that Jesus is the Messiah. They wanted to protect what was theirs. This was their scriptures. They wanted to guard it for themselves. This was about them. Now it's about the ends of the earth. So what's they do? Verse 5. They rush to Jason's house in search of Paul and Silas in order to bring them out to the crowd. Verse 6. But when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some of the believers before the city officials, shouting, "These men who have caused trouble all over the world have now come here, and Jason's welcomed them into his house. They're defying Caesar's decrees, saying that there's another king, one called Jesus." When they heard this, the crowd and the city officials were thrown into turmoil. Then they made Jason and the others post bond and let them go. As soon as it was night, the believers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. This is pretty mad, especially for Jason. I mean, he's been a Christian for max 3 weeks. So imagine, like, you know, Alpha course on week four now. So you just last week you worked out why Jesus had to die, and now you're working out, how can you have faith, and then you get like rammed and raided, and you're the leaders of the Alpha group, and you are brought out, and you're just about to do the chat. You just finished the meal. It's pretty disruptive. And he's got no idea what's going on. Probably had no idea that persecution came with being a Christian. And then he ends up having to kind of bail out Paul and Silas. It's pretty crazy. One of the most serious crimes of the Roman Empire was acknowledge the allegiance of any king other than Caesar. Paul was proclaiming that Jesus was the Messiah. There's no evidence here that Paul was proclaiming that Jesus was the King of Kings. We didn't know if Paul was shouting that at the top of his voice, but he might be preaching that we need all our allegiance to Jesus, and one day that Jesus' kingdom will come. But it could have been a way for the Jews to stop Paul's ministry. To stop Paul and Silas proclaiming, to get them charged with high treason, which has very fatal implications. Paul and Silas then left quickly, not wanting to bring more persecution to this very early, very like new church, and jeopardize Jason's security deposit of saying that Paul and Silas won't come here again. So I don't think, what's the application for us in this section? I don't think there's many people who come today who hate Scripture, who want to see the stop of the spread of the gospel. But potentially there's some parts of the Bible that we pick and choose. There's some parts we don't really like, and we want to ignore those parts. But all of Scriptures is God-breathed, it says. Do you hate the idea that Jesus had to suffer in our place? I know people who find that very hard to take, like Christians who find that very hard to believe. That Jesus had to suffer? That's gross. That he had to be a curse for me? That he was cut off? No. Jesus died on a cross to show me how much he loved me. No, he had to suffer and die. The wage of sin is death. And it pleased God to put the wrath of him on Jesus. Do you ever want to shut down conversations about Jesus? Some people who say they're Christians just don't always want to talk about the gospel. Don't always want to discuss Jesus. Want to just cut it down. Okay, that's enough. Okay, let's move on. We might remember of accounts of friends and family. Well, Christians want to just stop there. Okay, let's just shut this down. And then obviously we have friends and family in our lives who just want to shut the conversation about the gospel down completely. Like, you're not allowed to say this again in my house type thing. No. They hate Scripture. It repels them. They just don't want anything to do with it. History hasn't changed at all. And if you've ever answered yes to any of these questions, I pray that the Bereans would be a great inspiration to you. So, my third point, or do you seek the scriptures? So verse 10, on arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now the Berean Jews were more noble, were more noble character than those in Thessalonica. For they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. As a result, many of them believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. The Bereans are used as a positive example of how we should respond to Bible teaching. For example, it's like Jayesh today, just like the standing in the kids' slot, just like looking at the verses, like five centimeters away from the verse, like this. Examining it. Be like Jayesh. So the fact that they received the message with great eagerness, it says, probably meant that they were in hope of the Messiah, like Simeon. There's Simeon that he so much wanted to see the Messiah, that God promised that before he dies, he would see the Messiah. Or the three wise men searching for the Messiah. So they were probably searching and eager for the Messiah to come. A great eagerness. But they weren't naive about it. They wanted something to happen, but they weren't going to take Paul's word for it. They wanted to investigate it thoroughly. Being a Christian doesn't mean you're naive to reasoning or research. They examined the scriptures, it says. They examined the scriptures. It was worth for them to work hard to investigate what the word of God said and how Paul's teaching matched up. Did the prophecy of scripture match up with who Jesus, Paul was proclaiming? They examined it daily. This was an in-depth study. They were diligent about it. They didn't have copies of the Old Testament at home. They would have probably had one copy in the synagogue, and they probably just went there. They went there every day. They're going there every day. It's not once a week now. They're going every day. Maybe one person's reading the scriptures, reading Isaiah 52, 53. Everyone's crowded around the one, just hustling. Okay, what did he say? Is this right? They were eager. They were diligent. And as a result, many of them believed. It's a great example of willingness for Bible study. So what's the application here for us? So people who Jesus isn't their Lord yet, be encouraged to examine Scripture. If you've got questions, the Bible has answers. Be diligent about it. Seek it daily. It's not just a 15-minute exercise once a week, or it's not just when it comes up. If Jesus has the words of eternal life, where else do we go? We know how life is fleeting and how much more we need to examine it. We need to test it and see if this is true, because if it is true, then we need to believe. And Christians, with doubts, concerns and worries, examine the scriptures. Go to scripture. There's great commentaries and there's great Christian books. And sometimes the concern is that we rush to those more than we rush to the actual word of God and see for ourselves what God is saying, what is the answer. We need to make Scripture the sole base of truth. Because when we seek, like the Bereans, in Matthew 7, for everyone who asks receives, the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks the door will be opened. God responds to a seeker. If you seek God out, you'll find him. So kind of wrapping up at the last couple of verses. So amongst persecution, the gospel continues to spread and the church grows. So verse 13, but when the Jews of Thessalonica learned that Paul was preaching the word of God at Berea, some of them went there too, agitating the crowds and stirring them up. The Jews of Thessalonica weren't satisfied about driving out Paul and Silas from their city. They would think, well, it's a good idea to just travel 50 miles and cause some trouble there. 50 miles. They were very angry, jealous people who hated the message. Now, some people like go out the way, really go out the way to stop the spread of the gospel. Like, it's like, whoa. Wow. So what happens, verse 14, the believers immediately sent Paul to the coast, but Silas and Timothy stayed at Berea. Those who escorted Paul brought him to Athens and then left with instructions for Silas and Timothy to join as soon as possible. So the fact that Timothy and Silas stayed at Berea, and Paul instructed for them to do that, I mean, it just shows that Paul was very much interested and only had a heart for not just people, just fans of Jesus, converts. He wanted to make disciples. He wanted to build churches. That's God's A plan, disciples in churches. There's no other plan. So even in danger, Paul just left them. I'll go by myself. Turned out they didn't actually meet in Athens. Paul had to do that part of the ministry by himself. And next week's crazy. The chapter next week's crazy. Make sure you come to that. But so the church grows in faith and understanding under Timothy and Silas, discipling them. So in summary, we need to be involved some way, hopefully not by hating Scripture, but either seeking Scripture or proclaiming Scripture. Now, in order to proclaim Scriptures, we need our Bibles open. In order to seek Scripture, we need to try to do this daily. We need to come with an open heart, willing to receive. Find those answers that we don't yet know about. Do a Bible study. That's why we have Tuesday, Wednesday nights, whatever nights it is, midweek group. We have the Bible open. And you and your brothers and sisters are around Scripture, looking at it, working it out. Because once we understand Scripture fully, or just about enough, again, it's really not about us. We just need to know a little bit to be faithful with. Just get a couple of verses to know to open them up to. Maybe it's open up Romans 3:23 or Ephesians 2:8 and go, do you want to read this? It's my favourite verse. Do you want to read this? They're not waiting for the Messiah, but they're waiting for someone to fulfill their longings. If you haven't saw that sermon Alex did about a month back, watch that on YouTube. It's incredible. They're waiting for something to satisfy them. They're waiting to be loved unconditionally. They're waiting to find rest. They're waiting to find peace and they want hope. Show them Jesus and pray that the Holy Spirit will open up the scriptures to them.